Up until about 40 years ago, if you asked anyone in the world what they thought of when you said the word Canada, chances are they would say... And it's a great film, Rosemarie, but it's full of all those familiar stereotypes. Snow, water, trees, ice, moose, lumberjacks. Igloos, huskies, and of course, this. Thank goodness a guy named Pearson came along and gave Canada a makeover.
Hey, I'm not a lumberjack or a fur trader, and I don't live in an igloo. I speak English and French, not American. I can proudly sew my country's flag on my backpack. I believe in peacekeeping, not policing. Diversity, not assimilation.
People all across this country cheered for this commercial, and it wasn't just the beer.
It's our diversity, it's our peacekeeping, it's our two languages, it's our health care, it's our maple leaf flag. And all these things are the result of one man.
Canada is the second largest landmass, the first nation of hockey, and the best part of North America!
He's our country's greatest statesman. He is our best prime minister by a country mile, oblique stroke, 1.62 kilometers. He's a man who literally saved the world and won the Nobel Peace Prize. He is quintessentially us. He is, without question, the greatest Canadian, and his name is Lester B. Pearson.
For two centuries, Canadians were Mother England's most obedient children. In war after war after war, we followed her into battle. And then, just 10 years after the Second World War, another conflict threatened to engulf the world. It was called the Suez Crisis.
The Suez Canal, storm center of controversy.
This time, England and France had started.
Warplanes are winging their way to Egypt, and its bombers attack five key cities, including Cairo.
Canada was stunned. In fact, one British magazine said that our reaction was like finding a beloved uncle had been arrested for rape. And for the first time in its history, Canada did not say, "Ready, aye." Ready, as England went to war.
The fight is over control of oil in the Middle East. It has split the Western alliance,
which threatens Egypt with aggression.
Looks awfully familiar, doesn't it? But one thing at least was different. Canadian External Affairs Minister Lester Pearson. He's the world's most respected diplomat, and he's known simply as Mike. He heads to New York and the United Nations. In the corridors of the United Nations, the buzz goes up. What's he got? Pearson's got something. Can he do it? What's he got?
I don't think one watch.
Great powers have failed to resolve the conflict, but Pearson has the contacts, the skills, the trust, and he has the ability to find solutions where others can't. A Canadian may well be the last, best hope for peace. The General Assembly is in emergency session. The place is in an uproar. England and France have started bombing Egypt. Suddenly, the world is on the edge of nuclear war, and Pearson finds himself in the classic Canadian dilemma, stuck in the middle. In the early morning hours, he makes his way to the podium to deliver what he calls the most painful speech of his life. He hates what Britain has done, but an open break would be humiliating to the country he loves, second only to Canada. He must find some way for her to save face. If he fails, the war may spread. If he succeeds, he may achieve a lasting peace.
Mr. a plan for the setting up, with the consent of the nations concerned, of an emergency international United Nations force to secure and supervise the cessation of hostilities.
An emergency international peacekeeping force. Troops from neutral countries to stand between the two enemies and keep the peace. It's an extraordinary idea. Not to just stop wars, but to make sure they stay stopped. And he persuades all sides to accept it. He has resolved the crisis. It is his and his country's greatest triumph.
Pearson's peacekeepers are the guys who step into the middle of a fight and say, okay, fellas, cool it. And in the last 50 years, they've stepped into a lot of fights. In Cyprus, in Sierra Leone, in Bosnia, in East Timor. Peacekeeping has given us our heroes, our traditions, and our place in the world. Because of Mike Pearson, a blue helmet has come to mean peace and hope and Canada. It is our gift to the world.
Oh, no.
So where did Pearson, the peace guy, come from? As an 18-year-old in World War I, he kept a diary. It's full of the horrors he saw in a medical unit at the front. The field was a sea of mud, he wrote. The dead and dying would be moved to one side. There was little enough we could do for them. Nightmare days when we all worked till we dropped. Two years later, Mike got out of the mud and into the Royal Flying Corps. His flight instructor didn't think it was any place for a kid with the name of Lester. So he called him Mike, and the name stuck.
On his first solo flight, Pearson crash landed. A couple of days later, he was hit by a bus during an air raid blackout in London.
And these two incidents shook him badly. Something snapped in Mike. And it wasn't just his nerves. The ghastly experience of war had shattered his faith in God and in the glory of the empire.
Also from his diary, we spent hours trying to bring some reason to the senseless slaughter. For what? King and country? Freedom and democracy? These words sounded hollow now. War had turned Mike into one of the world's greatest peacemakers.
There are only a handful of these in the world. It is the Nobel Peace Prize. It's the only one in Canada, and it's Mike Pearson's. And he won it, in the words of the committee, for saving the world. Saving the world. Now, what other Canadian can claim that? What country can claim that? Oh, yeah, and what did Mike say when he was told that he won the prize? He said, gosh. Gosh.